First of all, thank you for inviting me here, and thank you all for being my audience today. I feel very privileged and honored to be here, really. And as some of you may have noticed already, I'm not a native speaker, so I apologize in advance for any 16 language slips. Right, I still remember reading the Silmarillion for the first time at the age of 12. I had previously discovered The Lord of the Rings and was eager to read more about elves and men and Middle-earth in general. Apart from being generally awed by the stories I had encountered in this book, there was one very short passage that got stuck in my head. It was the passage in which Eärendil, the mariner, asks his wife Elwing to make a choice for them both between the fate of men and the immortality of the elves. Elwing, as it is stated in the Silmarillion, chose to be judged among the firstborn children of Ilúvatar. The reason for Elwing's choice was poured into this very short clause, because of Lúthien. In spite of its shortness, this clause made all the difference to me, because I felt a peculiar sense of satisfaction to keep Elwing and Eärendil after losing Beren and Lúthien. What my 12-year-old self felt at heart found its more analytic explanation many years later when I came across Tolkien's essay on fairy stories and his argumentation for the necessary coexistence between catastrophe and eucatastrophe. This balance, in my opinion, and I think you would all agree, permeates all of Tolkien's works, and as Verlyn Flieger puts it, no careful reader of Tolkien's fiction can fail to be aware of the polarities that give it form in fiction. Moments of loss and catastrophe are interwoven with notions of comfort and hope, and each seemingly happy ending is always accompanied by a poignant pang of sadness. My presentation today is therefore concerned with this narrative principle of strategic duality, meaning basically the balance between catastrophe and eucatastrophe. In order to analyze how strategic duality is constructed, I'll draw on patterns of parallelism and oppositions that are widely used in epic narratives. In my opinion, parallels and oppositions come in two distinct patterns in Tolkien's works. The first pattern, parallel paths, denotes direct analogies between narrative elements, thereby emphasizing similarities. The other pattern, on the other hand, I've coined, maybe an unlucky term, but maybe we can discuss that later, distorting mirrors. And by that, I actually mean a kind of concurrent impression of similarities and oppositions. It's like when standing in front of a distorting mirror, you can see still the likeness, but at the same time, the very grotesque image of the original. I've called it distorting mirrors in order to grasp the idea of a pattern that maps out structural differences, but simultaneously retains an inherent likeness between narrative elements. By means of six examples, I will show how these patterns are employed in Tolkien's works to create this all-encompassing strategic duality between catastrophe and eucatastrophe. The first example of parallel paths is concerned with a key scene from The Lord of the Rings and the Book of Lost Tales. Both works feature a fated combat between good and evil, represented by Balrogs of Morgoth on one side, and on the good side by Gandalf the Maia and the elf Glorfindel of Gondolin. When comparing these two scenes, striking similarities can be identified. Among the most obvious are those: Gandalf and Glorfindel both face the Balrog in the mountains, both cover the escape of their friends and allies, and both perish with their enemies by falling into the abyss together. On closer inspection, however, even more parallels emerge. The imagery of light is very prominent in both cases. In the Book of Lost Tales, Glorfindel's sigil is described as a brave sun, and Gandalf's defiant words to the Balrog identify the Istari as the wielder of the Flame of Arnor. Arnor, of course, being the Elvish word for sun. Being descended from the golden tree of Lorelin, the sun is associated with pure fire, warmth, and hope, and thus provides a very strong contrast to the dark fire of the Balrogs. Moreover, I think both scenes interestingly see an initial draw. Gandalf and Glorfindel both die together with the Balrogs. Good and evil seem to neutralize each other by their mutual demise, and the score therefore seems quite even. Yet Gandalf and Glorfindel are both rewarded for their sacrifice. Both are sent back even more powerful than before, and again they are both associated with the radiating light. These are actually but two examples of very many, so I just chose this cute illustration. Glorfindel is described in The Lord of the Rings as a shining figure of white light, and for Gandalf we have his hair was white as snow in the sunshine, and gleaming white was his robe. The eyes under his deep brows were bright, piercing as the rays of the sun, and here we have the image of the sun. In my opinion, the strong resemblance between both scenes emphasizes the balance between good and evil and the perpetual struggle between both powers. But it also underlines the concept of self-sacrifice as something that cannot be understood and thus not be overpowered by evil. The return of both characters, and I know for Glorfindel it's still debatable whether he really returns, but in The Peoples of Arda there's this tiny snatch stating that Glorfindel actually is reincarnated in Lord of the Rings. The return of both characters, I think, after the painful experience of their deaths, is a very particularly powerful eucatastrophic moment for the reader, especially for Gandalf when he reappears in the Two Towers. Another interesting case of parallel paths is that between Lúthien and Arwen. Not only do they resemble each other in their looks, their fate is as you all quite know, similar too. Aragorn and Arwen's first meeting in the woods of Rivendell parallels that of Beren and Lúthien in the woods of Nazareth. Beren and Aragorn are likewise enchanted by the appearance of the women. And the fathers, Fingal as well as Elrond, are initially against the relationship and set the quest as a bright prize. Ultimately, Arwen's choice is the choice of Lúthien, namely to spend a lifetime with the man she loves, but to part from the circles of the world forever. And I think connected to that, we can detect another case of evening the scores. Just map that out for clarification. Lúthien and Beren sharing the doom of men, whereas Edriel and Tuas, similar constellation, had an elf woman and male human. And they share in the doom of men, and Tuor and Edriel and the doom of the elves, whereas we have the two half-elves, Aragorn and Arwen, who choose mortality, and Eärendil and Elwing, also both half-elves, who share the fate of the elves. Of course, there are many differences between the individual characters, but the emphasis, in my opinion, definitely lies on the striking parallels. With these couples, an intertextual link is established that functions like a golden thread almost across the enormous time periods of the different ages, adding further significance to the union between the children of Eru and, concomitantly, to the centrality of themes such as love and commitment in Tolkien. Works. In order to illustrate the second narrative pattern, I would like to start with an example from the tale of Beren and Lúthien. One protagonist of the tale is Huan, the wolfhound of Valinor. Huan is described as extremely faithful, a skilled hunter, and capable of human speech. His evil counterpart, or distorted image, so to speak, is presented in the shape of the hideous wolf Karkaroth. Guarding the gates of Angband, like Cerberus, the gates of Hell in Greek mythology, Karkaroth is described as a devouring spirit, tormented, terrible, and strong. And at least in the Lay of Lathian, he is also described as being capable of human speech, so there's another connection here. While Huan and Karkaroth represent antithetical powers, the angelic power of the Vala on the one hand, and the demonic corruption of Morgoth, on the other, their juxtaposition works precisely because of the correspondences. Both are canine creatures, both are bred by a Vala, both their destiny is preordained, and both their fate is tied. tied to the Silmaril. The fact that Karkaroth is actually created because of Huan, and that they are each the nemesis of the other, poignantly corroborates the image of the distorting mirror. Taking into account the earliest drafts of the story of Beren and Lúthien, it seems hence quite consistent, in my opinion, to drop the idea of Tivildo, the Prince of Cats, as a second antagonist to Huan. The omission of Tivildo, I think, allows for a stronger emphasis on the parallels between Huan and Karkaroth, and the theme of divine creation and demonic imitation. Right, two characters that also convey the image of distorted mirrors but do not simply contrast good and evil are the cousins Turin and Tuor. The two heroes have much in common, as you all know. They are both princes of Dol Guldur, both lose their fathers in the Battle of Unnumbered Tears, both are fostered by elves, lead life as outlaws for at least for a certain period of time, and they both gain admittance and renown in elvish kingdoms, as well as the love of an elf maid. All this underlines their close kinship and importance as heroes of men, but their paths soon diverge into opposite directions. Just like their contrasting looks, Tuor's golden-haired, whereas Turin is black-haired, their epithets also indicate their different fate. Tuor is called the Blessed, whereas Turin's self-chosen name, Bloodstained Son of Ilfeng, signifies the opposite, really. Not only does Turin cause the death of his best friend Beleg and of Finduilas, the elf maid who falls in love with him, he accidentally marries his own sister. When she kills herself and their unborn child out of shame, Turin finally takes his own accursed life. Tuor, on the other hand, is strangely lucky. He's almost chosen one, loves and is loved by Idril, manages to save his family from the sack of Gondolin, and is eventually granted access to the Undying Lands. A few other characters, I think, portray the two sides of the same coin, the blessing and curse of fate, catastrophe and eucatastrophe, as powerfully as Turin and Tuor do. My second to last example takes a closer look at the characterization of Gandalf and Saruman. I think it's one of the most prominent images. As you all know, they are both Maia sent by the Valar to Middle-earth in order to assist the free peoples against the domination of Sauron. While Saruman is corrupted by thoughts of power and the ring, Gandalf passes the test when being offered the ring by Frodo. Gandalf regards the hobbits of the Shire with respect and is able to see more in them than their rural facade of coziness initially suggests. Saruman's wisdom, on the other hand, turns to arrogance and contempt for the hobbit's perceived simplicity. Eventually, Gandalf and Saruman both experience temporary disembodiment after Gandalf's fight with the Balrog and Saruman's death in the Shire. The consequences of the deaths are totally different, though. Gandalf is sent back to Middle-earth to complete his task and is rewarded for his sacrifice with the highest rank among the Istari, whereas Saruman's spirit is denied by the powers of the West and subsequently vanishes into oblivion. Saruman in his corruption thus represents a distorted image of what the highest of the Istari should be like, and he's therefore replaced by Gandalf. The following quote captures this very adequately, I think. It's Gandalf speaking. "Yes, I am white now. Indeed, I am Saruman," one might almost say, "Saruman as he should have been." I would like to conclude my overview with a biblical motif that is employed in the Silmarillion and the Lord of the Rings alike, but to different purposes and outcomes. The motif of the fight between David and Goliath finds its first correspondence in the duel between Fingolfin and Morgoth after the Battle of the Southern Flame, and its second correspondence in the duel between Eowyn and the Nazgul, or the Witch King of Angmar. Both scenes seem to project a hopeless cause for the heroes as they are pitted against an enemy far beyond their power, and both scenes show remarkable parallels in terms of vocabulary and imagery. Eowyn and Fingolfin both armed with sword and shield, are strongly associated with light. They gleam beneath their enemies. Think often as an elf is associated with the star, whereas Eowyn as a human figure is linked to the light of the sunrise. In contrast to them, Morgoth and the Nazgûl are tall as towers, wholly clad in black, and cast a shadow over their opponents like a cloud. Furthermore, they both wear a crown made of metal, either iron or steel, signifying their status as highest authority of evil in the respective scenes. This huge discrepancy in height stresses the small chance of the hero's victory, and the image of the cloud visualizes the nightmarish nature and threatening to enshroud the tiny light of hope, really. There are, however, also significant differences. There comes this distorting mirror in again. For example, the divergent results of these two duels. Morgoth triumphs over Fingolfin, whereas Eowyn is able to defeat the Witch King, could derive from the different motivation that drives both characters. After the calamitous battle of the Southern Flame, Fingolfin is seized by a mad rage that causes him to challenge the Dark Lord. His action could hence be interpreted as an act of aggression and despair. Eowyn, on the contrary, faces the Witch King out of love for Theoden, whom she seeks to protect from a fate worse than death. It's a very Christian image here. The idea of despair is one of the major sins, and of course filial love, one of the strong motifs here. So Eowyn's motifs are essentially altruistic, and her victory over the Nazgûl signifies a victory of love and hope. And in connecting both scenes by means of the David and Goliath motif, an intertextual link again is established from the first to the third age, and it corroborates the idea of history repeating itself. However, the different outcome of the fight between Eowyn and the Nazgûl balances the catastrophic end of Fingolfin and kind of supports again the eucatastrophic message. Despite Fingolfin dying, we have here the victory, even though the chances were considerably small. Right, with these examples, I could hopefully show how the narrative pattern of parallel paths and distorting mirrors work together to achieve strategic duality, affecting not only peoples but also beasts of all ages across Middle-earth, and meshing characters, scenes, and motifs in an intertextual net. In that respect, I believe strategic duality to be an essential narrative principle in Tolkien's works. It functions as a catalyst, really, for Tolkien's eucatastrophic effect that lies at the heart of every good fairy story, and that so appeals to and can be understood by adults and 12-year-old children.